of my brothers and sisters here with the Patriot Guard. It's a sincere honor to be here to celebrate the lives of Mom and Dad. From the great gospel, Philippians 4:13 says, I can do all things through Christ Jesus who strengthens me. And I want to instill that with you today. So, I'm going to give everyone a round from a 21 gun salute in honoring of your loved ones.
Captain Todd Afshar, commander of the 548th ISR Group, Detachment 1. I stand here today wearing this uniform largely in part because of my grandfather. The funny thing is that my mom wrote this and she wanted me to read it because she didn't think she'd be able to make it through it. We'll see how much I get through. I'm just going to read. I'm not going to ad-lib, because if I start to ad-lib, I'm going to say things that I shouldn't. That's why I'm not a chaplain. Can I have some Kleenex, please?
Yes.
Thank you. Lyle and Gretchen McCart are survived by their two daughters, Kathy McCart Snyder and Karen McCart Afshar, their four grandchildren, Todd Afshar, along with my wife, Jane, and our son, Colin Lyle, who is named after my grandfather. Megan Afshar, Zoe Snyder, and Max Snyder. Lyle is survived by his older sister, Helen Morris. Gretchen is survived by her brother, Bob Bumgarner, and her sister, Pat Kincaid. Gretchen was born Gretchen LaRue Bumgarner on April 18, 1920 in Numa, Iowa, to Guy and Mabel Bumgarner, and was the eldest of eight children. Gretchen died May 14, 2010, and we kept her remains to be interred with her husband. From the beginning of her life, Gretchen was very intelligent. In kindergarten, she was promoted to first grade, and at the end of first grade, she was promoted to third grade. She graduated high school at age 16. That's something I did not inherit. Gretchen moved to Corydon to attend junior college and worked for the government. She rented a room from Ray and Mae Richards, who adored her as if she were their own child. Many of Mae's paintings are hanging in Oma and Opa's living room, and Oma and Opa is how we refer to our grandparents. Lyle McCart, our veteran here today, was born William Lyle McCart on February 10, 1922 in Corydon, Iowa, to Elgin and Mary McCart. He was their second child and was always referred to as Lyle, never William. He died August 21, 2013, 2 weeks after his great-grandchild was born. Just before Christmas in 1924, Lyle's father, Elgin, was killed in a fire. Mary's family surrounded her and her children, Helen and Lyle. They traveled to Montana to recover and rest. And in 1927, Mary married Iowa farmer Ben Coffey, along with his two daughters, Alta and Letha. Ben is often quoted as having told Lyle that he always wanted a son, and now he had one. Today, this would be called a blended family. But to Mary and Ben, it was their family, period. Lyle grew up on the farm doing all the typical farm chores, but he had something special that others did not. Ben bought him Midget, a Shetland pony. Lyle told many stories of riding Midget to school, tethering her to the clothesline in summer and sleeping outdoors with her, sneaking her into the kitchen when his mom wasn't looking, and how Midget would lick the white marble counter thinking it was sugar or a salt lick. Many of his younger girl cousins wrote to our family, telling us how Lyle would let them ride Midget, and then Lyle would slap Midget on the ass, making her run off the girls with the girls, all the while Lyle was laughing. Lyle also worked on both of his grandparents' farms on a relative's turkey farm, and at a Beatrice Creamery, where he drove a truck to the local farms buying milk. In 1942, while attending a dance, Lyle met Gretchen, and their lifelong love affair began. Several months later, they were engaged. Lyle entered the Coast Guard in 1942, and on April 2nd, 1943, Lyle was on leave. He went home, and he and Gretchen, along with another couple, went to Missouri and were married, because he didn't have to get a blood test. True story. Lyle was first stationed in Corpus Christie, where he did his training, then patrolled the Gulf of Mexico on a sub chaser. Later, he was transferred to New Jersey to patrol the Atlantic. Gretchen was able to secure a job at Fort Dix, New Jersey, and be near her husband. In 1945, Lyle and his unit were put on a troop transport to Long Beach, where they were to board ships to take them to the planned invasion of Japan. However, as they arrived in Long Beach, in August, the nuclear bombs had been dropped on Japan and the war was over. He called Gretchen to invite her to vacation with him in Long Beach, and while they were there, and while he waited to be mustered out of service, they never went back to Iowa. They made their home in Lakewood, California. Soon after leaving the service, Lyle was hired by Fuzz Harris, a Long Beach tailor, to apprentice as a clothes presser. Lyle quickly learned the craft and then continued to learn tailoring and running the tailor shop. During this time, Gretchen learned how to alter men's dress shirts and became the contract seamstress for the downtown Long Beach department stores and men's stores. Twice a week, she would take their daughters, Kathy and Karen, with her to pick up and deliver shirts, stopping to see Lyle at his tailor shop and taking the girls to fetch fresh roasted peanuts at Marymond's. Fuzz's brother Roy had his own tailoring business in Bellflower, California. When Roy would go on vacation, he hired Lyle to oversee the shop. In 1959, when Roy retired, he sold his business to Lyle and Gretchen. Gretchen was a lifelong student. She loved American and European history, along with almost anything that entailed sports. To try to get her daughters interested in history, she constantly shared with them interesting facts that she had read. Every year, the McCarts drove back to Iowa to visit relatives who would all travel to Mary and Ben's home to see the McCarts. Usually over 100 people would show up. Each year, Gretchen researched new routes to take back home, studied the history of various sites, and taught her family the history as they drove to and toured the sites. In the late 1960s, Gretchen went back to college to study German and history. Lyle and Gretchen bought their Lakewood home in 1951 using Lyle's GI Bill. Gretchen decorated their home and kept it immaculate, and Lyle put in the cinder block garden walls, made all the shutters for their home, and remodeled the kitchen by himself. Lyle and Gretchen worked 6 days a week, and on the seventh day, Gretchen cleaned her house from top to bottom while Lyle mowed the lawns, washed the car, and painted the house, along with the elderly neighbor's house next to them. In fact, one of the greatest compliments was given to Lyle by a neighbor who, seeing Lyle mowing his elderly neighbor's lawn, told his children, as he was driving them to church, "I'm going to church to learn to be a good neighbor, and there is Lyle McCart being a good neighbor." Thank you all for honoring our father and grandfather's life and his service to the country he so loved. If I may add one more thing, I'd like to recognize one of the greatest actions of his life, which was marrying his wife, Gretchen Bumgarner. While Lyle had the remarkable good fortune to be raised in the wonderful love and guidance of Ben and Mary Coffey's family, Gretchen was not so fortunate. In her early years, but Lyle's love and that of his extended family so enriched her and permitted her to soar and create a wonderful, loving life for her children, husband, and great circle of friends. She was a remarkable woman who made a deliberate decision to demonstrate love for her family rather than to perpetuate the misfortune of her early days. Her unqualified love for Lyle was a shining example for us and helped him to be the great father and man that he was. In the process of sorting through Lyle and Gretchen's possessions, their daughters, Kathy and Karen, came across a note in Lyle's nightstand. Gretchen had addressed the note to Lyle, saying, quote, "To the one I love above all else." Kathy and Karen thought this was a fitting and apt inscription for their monument, "Love above all else." We're so happy they're finally reunited in their eternal love together. Thank you, Patriot Guard Riders. I salute you all. And I thank you for your time and for your service and for taking the time off from your work and everything else that you have going on in your life.
It's an honor, sir.
Thank you. It's an honor to be in your presence this day. And I hope one of these days I'll be just like you guys. I know my family are very, very appreciative of you being here. Thank you all. Thank you, guests, for being here. Thank you, VA Affairs. Appreciate all your hard work. Thank you very much.